Now that we have seen which elements are most commonly used to make extrinsic crystallized silicon with substitutional doping atoms, we will show different techniques to obtain N-type or P-type dope wafers, as well as how emitter doping can be realized. In the last part of this video, we will focus on edge isolation of wafers after the emitter production process. A typical cross-section of a P-type based solar cell is shown here on the right. The p-n junction is located close to the front surface of the cell by a thin n-doped layer that we will call the emitter. P-type wafers can be produced by adding boron atoms to the silicon melt before casting ingots. This method is applicable to Troisulski casting for monocrystalline silicon ingots and silicon casting for multicrystalline silicon, as these production methods include a molten phase from which these ingots or wafers are casted. Adding the dopant atoms to the melt is the most straightforward method to obtain uniformly doped wafers. The second method to obtain uniformly doped P-type wafers is by solid-state diffusion, where the dopant atoms diffuse into the wafers in solid phase from a gas phase. This method is adopted in the production process of float zone wafers. The process of converting polysilicon rods into monocrystalline silicon ingots with a very high purity takes place in an inert gas environment, most commonly in argon. By adding diborane gas to the inert environment, a uniformly doped ingot is obtained by diffusion of boron atoms into the molten silicon. The dopant atoms will enter the crystalline silicon driven by a concentration gradient according to Fick's law that relates the rate of diffusion to the diffusion coefficient D. We will now turn our attention to the production process of the N-type emitter layer, here in orange. This layer is formed by doping the P-type wafer with phosphorus atoms. As the acceptor atoms are still present in this region, the doping concentration of the donor atom should exceed that of the acceptor atoms in order to create an N-type material. The first and most used method in the past is by solid-state diffusion from the gas phase. A phosphorus atmosphere is created by using phosphine gas, PH3, or phosphoryl chloride, with chemical formula POCl3. The wafers are placed in a furnace at 850 degrees Celsius to speed up the diffusion process. Phosphine gas, along with other process gases such as nitrogen or oxygen, flows into the furnace. When using POCl3, the process is somewhat different. POCl3 is a liquid, so it must be purged into the chamber by, for instance, nitrogen. At elevated temperatures, POCl3 will react with oxygen to form phosphorus pentoxide, which is a gas. Fick's law again dictates that the high concentration of phosphorus atoms in the environment will result in diffusion into the silicon wafers. POCl3 can also be used in a different way, where the doping atoms are brought into contact with the wafers in a solid phase. A gel containing POCl3 is spread out on each wafer, precisely dosing the doping concentration. Upon heating the wafers in a furnace, a diffusion glass is formed from which the phosphorus atoms can diffuse into the silicon wafer. This glass should be removed subsequently with plasma or wet etching after the diffusion process is finished. The last method to form an emitter layer on a P-type wafer is ion implantation. With this method, charged particles are accelerated towards the wafer with high kinetic energy. These charged particles are formed in a plasma chamber, but there are always other elements present in the plasma. The other elements are separated from the doping ions by a mass separator magnet. Only the ions with the correct mass and charge can pass the slit before bombarding the wafer. The penetration depth of the ions can be controlled by the kinetic energy, while the dose can be controlled by the ion beam current. In this way, a very precise doping profile can be obtained. Another advantage is that there is no need for an etching process, since there is no formation of a diffusion glass. However, the downside of this technique is that the surface of the wafer is damaged by the ion bombardment, creating a high defect density. Therefore, the wafers must be heated in a furnace for a set amount of time to restore this damage. This heating process is called annealing. We will now briefly discuss the doping profiles obtained using the discussed emitter doping processes. The dopant profile of a typical PN junction is not as ideal as presented in previous videos. It is virtually impossible to obtain a perfect boundary between the P and N-type material, and in reality this profile will change more gradually from P to N-type. There is, however, a difference in dopant profile obtained by solid-state diffusion or by ion implantation, as is pointed out in this graph. With ion implantation, a more precise control of the doping profile and dose for the emitter layer can be obtained. This method, however, requires expensive equipment which has only been available for the last decade or so. After the emitter layer has been formed on the front surface of the wafer, the edges of the cell will be N-type doped as well, especially when a diffusion process has been used. This requires further processing, as we will explain now. If contacts are placed on the front and back of the wafer without further processing, the increased density of free charge carriers at the edges of the wafer will result in a higher conductivity and thus to a lower resistance for current to flow from the front contact to the back contact of the solar cell, instead of flowing through an external circuit where it dissipates power. In other words, the edge of the solar cell has become a shunting path and should thus be removed. One way of doing this is by stacking the wafers tightly on top of each other and using a plasma etching process to remove a few microns of thickness from the side of each wafer. Silicon is best etched by a plasma containing tetrafluoromethane, or CF4, and oxygen. The second method is to make a laser scribe close to the edge of the cell that interrupts the shunting path from the front contact to the back contact. The shunt resistance of the cell is hereby increased such that most of the current will flow through the external circuit. To summarize this video, we have discussed the methods to obtain P-type doped wafers by adding boron to the silicon melt or by solid-state diffusion with diborane gas. An N-type emitter layer is produced with solid-state diffusion in a furnace through gas phase diffusion or by the formation of a diffusion glass. Ion implantation is used to obtain more precise emitter doping profiles. Finally, the doped wafer edge should be removed or interrupted to increase the shunt resistance of the solar cell when it is finished.